She looked at me and she said, "Mr. Hinton, would you like some tea?" And I told the queen that I would love some tea. And she said, "What would you like in your tea?" And I told her, "Some lemon." She sent the butler out to get some lemon. I put in my tea and we talked a little while long, and finally I get up and leave. And once I realized that in my mind I could leave this prison at any time, I did something that I said I would never do in life. I said I would never get married. But then, since I was where I was, I decided that I would get married, and I married the beautiful and lovely actress Halle Berry. Stayed married to Halle Berry for 15 long, beautiful years, and the thing that I loved about Halle Berry, she didn't spend any money. Everything I asked Halle was, "Yes, dear," and "Okay, dear," "It's fine with me, dear." And then, going into the 16th year, the Department of Correction did something that they rarely do for death row inmates. They showed us a film. They showed us a movie, and the movie was Speed. And there, for the first time, I saw the lovely and beautiful actor, Sandra Bullock. Seeing this lady driving this bus, I looked at Halle, and she looked at me, and I looked at Sandra Bullock, and it was as though Halle knew exactly what I was finna say. Finally, I built my nerve up and I said, "Halle, I'm going to divorce you. And I'm going to marry Sandra Bullock." And she said, "Okay, dear." I knew if any woman could drive a bus the way she was driving, imagine what she could do with a getaway car. And so I decided that I would marry Sandra Bullock in my mind. And then reality sunk in, and the guard was calling me, and he said, "Anthony, you have a legal visit." I said, "The state of Alabama don't provide you with a legal visit during post-conviction." He said, "Anthony, somebody's out there pretending to be a lawyer. Won't you get dressed and go see who it is?" And I get dressed and I go out there, and there's this lawyer from Boston. I asked this lawyer, "Who sent you?" He tell me a man by the name of Brian Stevenson, and I asked, "Who is Brian Stevenson?" And he tell me that he's out of Montgomery, Alabama, out of the Equal Justice Initiative. He tell me about how good this Brian Stevenson is. And I finally say, "He can't be that good." I said, "Because he have already made one fundamental mistake." And he said, "What is that?" I said, "Did you say you was from Boston?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Well, had this great Mr. Brian Stevenson checked with me before he sent you, he would have known that I am a beloved Yankee fan. And there's no way a Yankee fan and a Boston fan could ever do anything together." I said, "But for your sake, I'm willing to put my personal feeling aside and let you work on my case." And for the next 3 years, this lawyer from Boston worked on my case. And coming up to the fourth year, he came and he said, "Anthony, I think I can get you a life without parole." And I looked at him and I said, "Life without parole for who?" He said, "You." I said, "I could never stand up and say I did something when I didn't do it." I said, "I would prefer to die than to stand up and lie." I said, "If you can understand what I'm about to tell you," I said, "my mother told me that if I'm man enough to bend down and pick up a rock, and if I'm man enough to throw that rock, I should be man enough to say I throw that rock." I said, "I could never plead guilty to this." I said, "I understand you trying to save my life, but in a way, I would lose my life." I said, "I would prefer the state of Alabama to execute me for a crime that I know that I didn't commit than to stand up and tell a lie." I said, "But I need a lawyer that believes in me. I need a lawyer that is willing to go to jail for me necessary." I said, "And since you're not that lawyer, I'm going to fire you today." And as he went to the front door and I go back toward my cell, something come to me and say, "You got to be the dumbest person in the world. You fired the only lawyer that you had." And just as that thought came to me, another thought came and said, "You did the right thing. Always stand up for what you believe in. Always stand up for principle." And as I got toward myself, this God was watching TV, and I asked this God, who's he watching? He tell me this lawyer out of Montgomery, and I asked him his name, and I said, oh, that's the man. I asked him, would he mind if I stand there and watch for a moment? He said, yes. And Mr. Stevenson was talking about the death penalty, why we don't need a death penalty in this country. And for whatever reason, I knew at that moment, this is the lawyer that I need to represent me. And so that night, I wrote him a letter of thanking for sending the lawyer from Boston. And I told him I would like for him to consider being my lawyer. But before he said yes or no, I would like for him to read my transcript. I said, and if you find one thing in my transcript that point to my guilt, do not worry about becoming my lawyer. Do not worry about sending me another lawyer. I am fully prepared to die for something that I didn't do. And if the state of Alabama seemed deemed to take my life, then so be it. I am okay with that. 3 months later, I get a response that he would read my transcript. 5 months after that, I get a letter that he had called the prison and he was coming to see me. Ladies and gentlemen, I cannot explain to you, but the moment I shook this man's hand, I knew that God had sent me his best attorney. We sit down there and we began to talk about our childhood, and then we went into the case. I said, Mr. Stevenson, I need you to do me a favor. And I know that your lawyers is against inmates telling you what to do. I said, but I need you to hire a qualified ballistic expert. I said, the state of Alabama is saying that the gun that they got from my mother's house is the gun that fired the fatal bullets in these restaurant managers. I said, I know that they are telling a lie. Mr. Stevenson looked at me and he said, well, I was going to hire a ballistic expert anyway. And I looked at Mr. Stevenson and I said, no, I'm not explaining myself right. I said, Mr. Stevenson, I need you to hire a white man. And I need this white man to be from the South. He said, why from the South? I said, Mr. Stevenson, I have lived in the South all of my life. And the South only recognized one of their own. I said, Mr. Stevenson, no matter how good a white female can be, she can be the best of the best, but her word would be no good on that witness stand. I said, it definitely cannot be a person of color. They were definitely no good. I said, I need this white man to be from the South, and I need him to believe in the death penalty. I said, but above all, I need him to be the best of the best. And I need him to tell the truth. Mr. Stevenson left the prison that day, and 3 months later, the guard said, call your attorney. I called Mr. Stevenson, and he said, I found the expert that you have requested. But I need to tell you, I found three of them. Two of them live in Texas and one of them live in Virginia. He said, Ray, they are the best of the best. He said, but I need to tell you that they testify 98% of the time for the prosecution. They put men on death row. They have never testified to get one off. Are you sure these are the men that you want? I said, Mr. Stevenson, did they promise to tell the truth? He said, Ray, they said they would tell what the evidence showed. And I said, if you're able, hire those three experts. I can't tell you what day or what month they came to Alabama, but they came at three separate occasions. And when the last one did his finding, they all met. And they all concluded that the gun that the state of Alabama said matched, indeed did not match. They went as far as trying to manipulate the gun to make it match. Even that, they was unable to do. We take this evidence to the Attorney General at that time, who was Bill Pryor. Asked Bill Pryor to re-examine the bullets, and he said it would be a waste of the taxpayer money to take 1 hour to re-examine those bullets, and he refused to do so. For not doing his job, George W. Bush appointed him to a federal lifetime appointment. The next Attorney General was Troy King, and he too refused to take 1 hour to re-examine the bullets. And the next Attorney General was Luther Strain, and he too refused to take 1 hour to examine the bullets. I sit on death row an extra 16 years because these three men refused to take 1 hour to re-examine the bullets. They didn't examine the bullets because they already knew that the bullets didn't match. But there's no law that requires them to re-examine the bullets. And while I'm sitting there for 16 extra years, I get worried that the love of my life have passed, and that was my mother. And I tell my attorney to damn that case. I don't give a damn about this case. If the state of Alabama want to execute me now, so be it. Without my mother in this world, I don't care. And I hung up without saying thank you or goodbye. And it was as though my mother came in my cell and stayed in my ear. And she said one thing that she had never said to me. She told me how disappointed she was that I was willing to give up so easy. The next morning, I called Mr. Stevens and told him to give the state of Alabama all the hell that he could give them. Mr. Stevens informed me that the judges in Alabama refused to do what was right. We needed to go to the United States Supreme Court. We filed my brief to the United States Supreme Court, and the United States Supreme Court did something that they have never done in the history of the court. All nine judges ruled in my favor. And yes, today I'm still having trouble to believe that Clarence Thomas ruled in my favor, but he did. We sent the case back to Birmingham. We go before the judge. And the prosecution informed the judge they have lost the gun in question. The judge give them time to find the gun. They find the gun. We go back to court and they say, Your Honor, we found the pistol in question, but we are sadly to inform the court that we have lost the bullets to the gun. She give them time to find the bullets. And all this time, I'm still riding away in a prison cell. The prosecution called one of his own experts that he used 30 years ago and asked him to come and re-examine the bullets one last time. He comes back and he informed the prosecution, and I quote you his words, "I do not see what I saw 30 years ago." But he saw exactly what he saw 30 years ago. Bullets is like fingerprint, they do not change. The state of Alabama had every intention of executing an innocent man for something that they knew from day one. Without even being man enough to come to court. They filed through electronic and advised the court that they no longer would seek this case any further. 30 years of pure hell. And to this day, no one in the state of Alabama have had the decency to say I'm sorry. How is it that we live in a system that it takes 30 years of a man's life and no one can say I'm sorry? Did they not say I'm sorry because I'm black? I truly don't want to believe that. The state of Alabama was going to take my life, and they called it justice. My question to you this morning, where is my justice? Who do I see to get justice? Where do I go to get justice? Am I supposed to just be okay with giving 30 years of my life? How do I get justice? But a more important question, what is justice? Can anyone tell me what is justice? 30 years I lived in this cage. Solitary confinement. And the only way that I could escape, I had to use my mind to believe that I was free. And here we are thinking that the justice system is fair. The justice system is badly broken. There's two sets of justice in this country. For those who have money and for those that don't have money. You have been led to believe that the scale of justice is blind, but I want to inform you this morning that that is a costume mask. She can see. She know what race you are. She know what college you went to. She know what neighborhood you live in. She even know how much money you have in the bank. And when you find yourself in her courtroom, she put all that together. And it has already been determined whether you're going to be found guilty or not guilty. Yes, I want you to know that there are and was and still is some white men on death row. I want you to know that the justice system need an overhaul. They need the justice system to be fair, because some of you in here is going to find yourself in her courtroom. And one day you're going to say, that man told me about the justice system. I am a firm believer that what affects me today very well can affect you tomorrow. Since I've been home, I had people to come up to me and say, Mr. Hinton, I am so sorry for what happened to you. But isn't that the price we pay for justice? Wouldn't you call it a casualty of war? And I look at that person and I said, being truthful to yourself, you don't have to be true to me, but being true to yourself, how would you feel if it was your father, your mother, your brother, your wife, someone that you really love and care about, would you feel that it is a casualty of war then? We need to stop this believing what the politician tell you. The state of Alabama had every intention of executing me for a crime that they knew damn well that I didn't commit, and they would have gotten away with it, but only two things they didn't foresee. The state of Alabama didn't know that I had a personal relationship with God, and the state of Alabama didn't know that God was going to send me his best attorney. And once the state of Alabama came up against the best lawyer, the state of Alabama no longer could lie, they had to concede. I was the 152nd exoneree, and since I've been out, four more have been found to be innocent. How many men and women need to be exonerated before this country decide that we don't need a death penalty? Because once you kill an innocent person, it's too late, you can't bring them back. These are 156 men and women that was able to get the right lawyer and able to get off. I'm sure I'm just dumb enough to know that innocent people have been executed. The government won't tell you, but every day in this country, the government kills someone in your name. You can sit here and you can pretend that you don't know it, but that blood is on your hand, because that's the government that you elected. When you do nothing, it tells me that you're a part of it. When you say nothing, it tells me that you are part of it. You agree with it. Those men that put me on death row didn't email me. They didn't fax me. They didn't call me. They didn't text me and ask me for forgiveness. I forgave them on my own. I didn't forgive them so they could sleep good at night. I forgave them so I could sleep good at night. Forgiveness is not about the other person. Forgiveness is about yourself. I am one that believes that if you truly want freedom, you have to forgive. That old gray house that you saw in that film, I got out and I fixed it up through generous donation. I had money left over. And after sleeping in a fetus position for 30 long years, I decided that I would buy me a king-size bed. But I didn't just buy any king-size bed. I bought me a California king-size bed. And in that California king-size bed, I looks at it, and I'm thinking that I'm going to enjoy sleeping in this big bed. But I cannot go to sleep unless I bring my knees up toward my chest. 2 years were not erased for 30 years I've done. Every morning at 2:45, I am up. Because for 30 years I had to get up for breakfast at 3 a.m. Whether I want it or not, the law requires them to wake you up and offer you breakfast. And I'm one of those that wants them up. I'm up. I have the ability to shower all day, every day, 10 times a day, for as long as I want. But I find myself showering, just like I'm on death row, every other day. State of Alabama opened the door and they didn't say Do you need to see a psychiatrist or psychologist? Taking 30 years of my life. But I do something now that every night, if you happen to pass by my house, you will see me outside at 10:30. Why 10:30? I don't know, but every night I go outside and I look up and I see the stars and the moon, because for 30 years I was not able to see the stars nor the moon. Every time it rained, perhaps you run out of the rain, but I walks in the rain. And every time it rained, for some reason, my little niece is with me and she looks at me and she says, "Come on, Uncle Ray, get up under the umbrella." And I said, "No, Uncle Ray, gonna walk in the rain." She look up at me and she said, "Uncle Ray, it's just not natural for a man to walk in the rain like that." And I look at my little niece and I say, "For 30 years, not even a drop rain was allowed to fall on my body. I want to enjoy." I goes out and I enjoy looking at the stars and the moon, because I realize that it can all be taken away from you. And as I lay there in that 5x7, I wish that I could see the stars one more time. I want you to know that you may feel secure that you won't have to deal with the system, and I hope you don't. But when you find yourself on that other side, you will see that the system is nowhere you thought it would be. The prosecution will never tell you that they take innocent men and women to court every day. They will never tell you that, as taxpayers, you are providing meals and clothes and housing for innocent people. And yes, I hate to be the one to inform you, some of you white people will end up in prison too. You just haven't ran across the right DA or the wrong crooked police. And then you will find yourself saying, "It is true. The system is not fair." If any of you think that there's not innocent people on death row, I'm here to tell you that there are. I left 200 men, and I believe with every fiber in my body that I left at least 5 innocent men on death row. The system will have you to believe that you are entitled to counsel, and you are. The system will tell you that during a capital murder trial that you are subject to get a divorce lawyer. The system will tell you that you may get a tax lawyer. It don't say what type of defense you are entitled to. It don't say how long, just long as that person have license to practice. Ladies and gentlemen, the system is badly broken. And I am here today because the system is going to be left up to you young people. You have to ask yourself what type of system you want to live in and what type of system you want your children to live in. If you're satisfied with the way the system is, then do nothing, say nothing. But the moment you find yourself where I was, continue to do nothing and say nothing. Thank you for listening to my show.
Pastor, and I just want to thank you for sharing your story and sharing your heart with us.
Thank you.
And we don't have a long time, but I wanted to see if anybody had a question or two that you would like to ask. One question that I have for you is, in order to get involved, you said to do nothing. What can we as citizens do to change the system? How do we get involved in that arena?
By simply going to EJI website, or also when people are running for office, district attorney, whether they're senators, because they're the one that makes the laws. You need to read up as much as you can about this individual. You need to see what they believe in, compare that to what you believe in. Don't be afraid to walk, write them, ask them questions. If you can, visit them. You know, the system, we have 2 million people incarcerated in this country. That's more people than in the third world country. And as taxpayer, you should be more concerned that your tax dollars is being wasted. And I am a firm believer that you have to start getting involved with these issues, because somebody in here will find themselves on the other side, whether they did it by guilt or they just did it like I did. Somebody thought you did something. And it started with voting. It started with going on the internet to check out and find out what these individuals believe in. And if they don't believe in what you believe in, call them. You know, I meet people every day that believe in the death penalty. But I have people that come up to me and say, I believe in the death penalty, but I don't want innocent people to be executed. And there's only one way that we will never execute innocent people. And that is that we don't have a death penalty. So I would ask people to just start going on the internet, finding out what you can about a candidate. Don't vote on racist line, gender line. You know, it's I was up at Princeton last week. A young man got up and said, well, you was in prison when Barack Obama was elected president. How did that feel? I said, honestly, I didn't give a damn whether Barack Obama got elected or not. I'm trying to save my own life. I said, but if you voted for Barack Obama because he was black, then you did the wrong thing. We should start voting for people that have all of our best interests at heart and not theirs. And most politicians, as long as they get their pockets fat, they're okay with where they ever go on. We in this predicament because we never do nothing, we say nothing, and we feel that we can't do nothing. Start a debate with people that you don't know. Write essays and put them in the Birmingham newspaper. Call the senators and talk to the senators that represent your district or whatever. And if you truly believe that the death penalty is wrong, start talking to your senator and ask him to bring and sponsor a bill that will abolish the death penalty. I truly hate the fact that somebody right here will get caught up in the system, and they gonna see it is a system that is badly broken. And the politicians do not want you to know that it's broken, because that's how they keep their livelihood going.
Well, thank you again. Any questions? Thank you again so much.
Yeah.
You have a question back here? All right, quickly. Robin, my love.
Let me first say that I am often asked, Mr. Hinton, what do you think about Black Lives Matter? I am the only one to ask that question because I am a true believer that all lives matter. It is so true that Black people stands a better chance of going to prison. In fact, statistics shows that from the ages of 15 to 25, one out of every three Black male, one of them will end up in prison for a crime that he may have done, he may not have done, but they, one of them will end up in prison. I am not with radical movement. I am with movement that challenged the system. When I tell you that the system is badly one-sided, it is badly one-sided. And I would just say, as all Blacks, we need to learn that the sacrifice that other Blacks made, we don't turn out to the polls and vote. We sit back and we do nothing. We complain and come to find out we didn't even get our sorry butt up to go vote. And so you have no voice when you don't exercise your right to vote and learn to pick people that have your interests. I often tell people I don't care what race is in office. All I ask them to be is fair, to mean to everybody else. But Black students, Black people need to start sitting at home talking to your sons, because they are the ones that come through the back gate in these prisons, and they come through the back gate because, again, you didn't get up and you didn't help make no policy. You feel that you can't help make policy, but you can. I would ask you to get your organization, go on the website, write EJI, ask for pamphlets, spread them out, ask your white counterpart to come in and join you and give their opinion. And when we all can join together and share our opinion, we may not agree, but we don't have to fall out. We want the system, of all the system, we should want the justice system to work for everybody. Because for 30 years, the actual perpetrator was still out there terrorizing the business community and perhaps someone else when the police didn't do their job and the prosecution. And we should demand that the prosecution, the police, all do their job. And when they do their job, all of us will feel safer. And don't do your job just because of a certain race. Do your job on everybody. Make the system as fair as you can. But I would advise you, the best way is to go to EJI. Get on their website, and they will send you everything you need for you to know which way you should go and how to go.
Thank you.